It's a great pleasure to be here. Very exciting conference and very exciting people. Some that I know, that I'm meeting for the first time. I wanted to come back on our own experience in building a centers, but also on our vision of what could be digital humanities at European scale. The story of the Digital Humanities Laboratory, which is now Digital Humanities Institute in Lausanne, has some similarities with other centers in Europe. I mean, we were also a young center 5 years ago when we were created. We've been lucky in having the possibility of hosting the Digital Humanities Conference in 2014, and as many cases, this gave us a very interesting boost in putting Lausanne as a place in... As a place on the world map of digital humanities. Following the keynote of this morning, we also been careful in developing, I would say, our regional and local cooperation in our own ecosystem. We have a very strong link with the University of Lausanne, with which we co-hosted the Digital Humanities Conference 2 years ago. And we have a lot of local projects in Switzerland, and in our region. But maybe one of the things which differentiate the lab from other, I would say, approach in digital humanities in the world, that we're not so much, I mean, our target users are not the humanists, our target users are not even the academics. I mean, we have a kind of very strong feeling that digital humanities has a role to play at a worldwide scale for things we deal with society. And this puts us in a situation a bit different, because it's go beyond the local politics, beyond the problems of making digital humanities resisting or emerging as a discipline, but really showing to the world that digital humanists have, a crucial role to play. So that's why we started to develop international collaboration throughout that aim. And we progressively develop tools and an idea on how to actually show this and demonstrate it. What could be, the role of digital humanities? Well, there are many of them, and I'm going to show you one of the things which we believe is extremely important, and maybe starting from a societal observation. I mean, maybe for the last 20 years, we're seeing something a bit silent, which is happening, but which is extremely worrying. This is a kind of... tectonic evolution between two continents which are separating themselves. If you want to choose a date, choose 2000, the year of the millennium bug. You know, the millennium bug did not happen, but still it was showing a kind of division from a moment where we had some dependency with computers and a moment where memory was entirely mediated by actually computer and computer infrastructure. And what we've been seeing in the last 20 years with the digital turn is a kind of densification of the information system, and also a type of metamorphosis. I mean, we have now experiences with our present where you can zoom in any part of the earth, you can actually see social networks, infrastructure, and linked between people explicited. I mean, you have a very big now, a very dense present. And apart from being extremely interesting, this present, these information system of today are progressively more and more incompatible with information system of the past. That means that the thing, and when I'm talking about the past, I'm not talking about 2,000 years ago, I'm talking about the year 1990. I'm talking about all the things which were before the year 2000. These two continents, they are drifting away. That means that the world for the big data community is starting 10 years ago, 15 years ago, maybe 20 years ago, but that is also very, very like the prehistory of big data. So this is causing a problem. This is causing an everyday problem. I mean, the fact that the past is disappearing is creating problems in terms of psychological presence to the world. Here, I made a kind of representation, maybe contrasting the situation on the 20th century, where we had a kind of sense of trajectory. We were coming from somewhere, and we were heading somewhere else, and that was coming in some form of normal evolution. Here, the more the past is far away, the more the future, of course, is far away. And that creates a situation which has impact on politics. You know, direct democracy makes some choices which are based on what in culture in general, but mainly access to the past is one of the key element when you define culture. It has impact on economics. I mean, if you want to make prediction, and this is one of the I would say, promise of big data. Well, it's difficult to make prediction about the future if you just take into account 5 years or 10 years. And in most cases, it's not even the case. I mean, predicting the future in many cases is linked with long-term prediction. These have impact in other sciences. I mean, the fact that progressively the past disappear is something which is extremely worrying, and it's potentially something which is, I mean, as worrying as climate change, as worrying as some of the big problematics of our time. This is why we've been arguing since the beginning of our initiative in Lausanne, progressively trying to convince people that digital humanities have a crucial role to play for society at large, and that means that we must change the scale of digital humanities project to make them as structures as the one on health, climate change, quantum computing, and this is as important. I mean, in meeting like this one, it's not just about how we survive as digital humanists, it's how we can actually be as organized, as structures, as in the other disciplines which don't even ask them questions about why they are there for. We got lucky to have an opportunity to try to make at least an attempt on that direction, and these are what are called the FET flagship. So Future and Emerging Technology Flagships are extremely a large European initiative that can receive financing between 500 million to 1 billion euros. So it's, of course, beyond the scale of any of our research projects usually, but it already happened once. I mean, there was one project about the brain finance with this scheme and another project about a new material called graphene. And the European community decided to reopen a call. And this time we decided to have at least a digital humanities project in competition. So we have one which is in competition with 24 other projects to become a European flagship, and there's going to be a selection next week, in fact, which going to downsize this list of 24 projects and thematics to only 5 or 6. And so we are living a pretty interesting moment. The project is called Time Machine. It's the only project of that list which is at the intersection of computer science and humanities, or deal with culture and cultural heritage, or name it however you want it. All the other are dealing, of course, with other elements of society. We were lucky to have the support of many important international programs, and that was one of the things which was important since the beginning, because, of course, Europe has been investing in these things for quite a long time. I mean, it's not necessarily in the case of the FET flagship, but in other elements. And so both Europeana, both Daria, and other European programs gave their support and their endorsement to the initiative, among them also Icarus, which is 160 archive, or CERL, which is about 300 libraries supported the element, IIIF, which is this new emerging standard for cultural heritage, is supporting the H2020 project READ, which is about recognizing and written document at large scale, is also supporting, etc., etc. So that means 12 supporting programs and 60 active partners, 400 archive and libraries, if you count them, if which are part of the program. So you can have the list in the website timemachineproject.eu. And if you plot them on a map, well, this is covering quite a big part of Europe. So this starts to resemble as something at European scale. So what why are these institutions are joining forces? Well, I mean, they all have different ideas, different goals. So as usual, I mean, and at that scale is difficult, but they agree on some of these things. Why is that? Most of them would like to have documents of the past as easily searchable as documents of the present. Just think of like Google. I mean, you type a name in a document of the last 1,000 years and you want to find it as easily as you find it for modern document. This seems reasonable as a wish. It's difficult in practice. Several of our partners want to travel through time as easily as we travel through space. What do we mean by that? You know, it's having a slider on your Google Maps and then change the year and see how the place was 50 years ago, 100 years ago, 500 years ago, 1,000 years ago. So the question whether this is possible or not, what it means epistemologically speaking, but that would be something or on the very efficient way to bring back the past in the present. And then maybe more generally, there's the idea to create some form of big data of the past. not only in terms of data, but in terms also of cultural heritage technologies. I mean, and we want all this to be common resources for the future, shared resources at the level of Europe, because in any case, if it's not going to be done through that type of means and through an heavily implication of the university and academia, it's going to be done by other groups, and that could be potentially a problem when you see, of course, the role of culture in society at large. Just to give an idea, I mean, now time is not something which is important on the internet, but it will be in any case. Facebook in 50 years from here will deal most with dead people than living people if it's still there. So we will become an heritage site if it still exists. Google will become an archive. It's already an archive, but you're going to be an archive for decades already in 50 years. So we're not sure these actors are the best actors to do this job. We're not sure even they want to do this job, and it's because it's not part of their business either. And so the fact of actually anticipating that change seems important. The general idea around all this is that documents are time harnessing device, but that using massive documentation, you could put time in motion again. So we actually have a bit of experience in this because we've been working with University Ca' Foscari and the State Archive in Venice on trying to demonstrate how could actually work in a particular case in a particular city, which is the city of Venice. It's a city which is very different from many other cities, so to some extent it's not an example, but in fact most of the thing I'm going to show you actually scale pretty well to most cities and situations in Europe. So here you see an example of the of what we're dealing with Venice. This is 80 kilometers of document. The Venice State Archive is actually holding this document and this continuity because Venice had the particularity of being a continued administration for more than 1,000 years when Napoleon arrived in the beginning of the 19th century. So we're dealing about shelves full of registers, document administrative records. We're dealing with maps, but not one or two maps. We're dealing with thousands of maps, potentially forests of maps like the one that you're seeing here. So you have a situation which is really the feeling of these big data. When you visit this type of places, you are feeling that it's not that it's going to work with traditional method. You need to join forces. You need actually to map these documents and turn them into information system. So what are we dealing with in a case like this? Administrative record, testaments, any law that was passed to the Republic, different type of information dealing with contracts, all the elements that make a state functioning. And they were a bit like the Google of the Middle Ages. They were keeping trace of everything, essentially. All these documents were different places in Venice, and they got regrouped in one of the biggest buildings in Venice, which is the Convegno dei Frari, which after the Napoleon arrived became a public space, used to be a religious one. It's 300 rooms, and it's the first thing we did when we started the project was to model it in 3D, because an archive is a volume of volume, and the first thing you have to understand is how actually these volumes are organized in space in order progressively to transform them into something which is digitally transformable. The big idea is to turn this into an information system. For this, you need at least three steps. You actually need to digitize those, so creating images out of this document. This is one of not the most easy one. Then you need to index them somewhere or another and be capable of searching in these oceans of images. And then you need to create a kind of graph which is linking some entities in this document, people, places, and other type of information, so that you can have, I mean, a very simple use cases. I want to be capable of typing the name of a Venetian, for instance, Battista Nanni, and I want to find all the documents dealing with that person. Seems simple, but you need at least these three steps if you want actually to do that sort of thing. Digitization will not be the main subject of my talk. We organize some digitization center in that particular places, and also in other places where we work in Venice. And these are simple, spaces where we adapt the typologies of scanners to the different typologies of document. And then when we found something that works well, we duplicate the scanners. This is directly managed by the archivists themselves, in a sense that it's not the role of a university like EPFL to actually do this job. So we just help them to pass this. What we do instead is developing new technology, like that particular technology for scanning books without opening them. It's based on tomography elements. 4 years ago, everybody thought we were crazy about this. Now there's at least 3 groups in the world competing who is going to be the first machine to do this. It's actually working for the type of document we're dealing with, which are containing some iron-based ink. So if you have a bit of metal in your ink, this is something that can open new avenue in digitization, speeding up process, permitting to read document that you cannot read otherwise. Just to give you an example, we have 100,000 testaments in the State Archive in Venice, which are unopened. And actually, for opening them, you need to have a legal person with you, even if they're 400 years old. So this is opening some new avenue for that type of information. Then all these images, these oceans of information, goes into different pipelines where they're going to be pre-analyzed before they're even looked at by a humanist, a scholar, students, in order to transcribe and annotate them. Here we have an example of a written document. So the written document will go from several steps of pre-processing in order for instance, to detect where is the text in the document. It seems simple, but in some documents which are heavily damaged, it's kind of difficult. And then progressively analyze the shape of each word or word blob which is present in the document. So the idea is not to do full transcription. It's very difficult for the moment, although we have a European project which is dealing with this now, is to actually be capable of matching words which are likely to be the same. So in a page like this one, I will analyze all the different automatically analyzed segments and try to find the matching segments. This can be done by various techniques. I mean, there are techniques used with deep learning, which we use quite a lot now, but it's in some cases, it can also be done with simpler method. On that particular image here, you see twice, for example, the word nobis. And, well, the shape of the word is recognized to be similar simply because there's a very simple mathematical transformation which is linking one with the other. So when we're sure or almost sure about this, we're making a link between the two nobis, but we're doing also that with all the nobis which are on the page, but also with all the nobis which are on the register, but also with all the nobis which are in the archive, provided they are written in the same way. And that makes that when we have someone, an historian, an archivist, a student, which is transcribing that particular word, is not doing one transcription, but hundreds of thousands. And this is typically the type of human-machine relationship we are exploring to see how fast and how efficient this can be. Same approach is done with cadastral maps. So we have thousands of cadastral maps. This is the case of the Napoleonic cadastre in 1808, giving a geometric representation of the city. Very precious because you have the geometry which is shown. It's the oldest map which is conserving the geometry of Venice. And for each of these parcels, you have also a number, which is an idea of which permits to know about property names, who is renting, what type of activity in the given parcels. We have developed a particular pipeline to analyze, because these are standardized documents, standardized from 200 years ago, but still standardized, to automatically detect the shape coming from the pixels to the actual the geometry, and to check where are written the actual index, so that we're capable of automatically reading them. It's much simpler to read that sort of thing than the other type of documents. So this is something that is working pretty well with extremely good percentage of success. And same thing also for other type of representation. We have part of the project which is dealing with scanning 1 million photographs of artwork, which is a kind of very complementary fund compared to the administrative document of the State Archive. But still, this represents many, many different things. And so now we have a deep learning technology for recognizing again, common places, not necessarily a particular places. It's the same idea that for words, regrouping these different images into different clusters corresponding to what is likely to be the same places. And again, when we would know where the place is, we're going to be capable of putting them at some places in Venice. Here, I'm showing the example for Venice, but we have also represent images in that database of many other places in the world and in Europe. This is, again, some form of pre-processing, pre-training that you do in order to tag, analyze the document even before actually you start to tell what these things are. And this is now becoming possible with very good results. Now, the steps after is going to that particular graph. I mean, being capable of extracting the information. Here, I have a tax declaration from Battista Nanni, always him. He has to declare to the states what he's owning. And so I will summarize by a simple graph saying, well, in that particular document, I have Battista Nanni living with two other persons at a given place. This is what I will retain for the document. All the rest will be not analyzed. He's doing that 30 years later, another tax declaration, another snapshot of his life, two other persons. Given another place, this is another snapshot of his life. We are lucky with Battista Nanni because he's a noble person, so we found all this genealogy in the Libro d'Oro, which is a particular book in Venice, where all the genealogy of the Venetians are shown. So we get part of his family pretty easily. And he's also the ambassador of Venice in Paris, so every month he's writing a letter to the Republic, and each letter contains people, places, which we also aggregate. So this is the network of Battista Nanni. It's a kind of Facebook of the past, if you want. And each of the nodes in that network are the beginning of other networks. And so if you do that recursively, you're progressively creating this huge graph of information, you see, which is pretty different from the image themselves. It's the extracted information from the actual content. And this is something you're going to be able to exploit in different ways. So the same way that we have these homologous points, which is the same person in different documents, which permit to attach information, you have the same thing for place. Here I have the representation of Venice of today with the exact coordinate. I can also align this document with representation of Venice in the 1808 if I find some common elements, a corner of a given church, some particular element that didn't change over 200 years in that case. And then I can also do that for much older document. Here it's a map of the beginning of the 16th century. These things come on, starts to be attached with one another across time through these homologous points, and this is going to be the base for progressively articulating all the documents about the past. If, to give you an example, this is the representation of Venice of today in 3D, 2016. I can align this with the photographs that are taken by our team on a given square, here, San Giacomo di Rialto. Then we produce cloud points based on this, which permit to align precisely with Canaletto painting of 1740, which is the basis of a 3D modeling of that given part, which is always aligned with the representation of today, which we can align with the 1808 cadastre, on which we find a particular parcel, for instance, 9006 here, which is a particular shop, which we'll find in a given Sommarioni, another document, which is telling us that on that particular parcel is Francesco Raspi, which was inhabiting that given parcel. That Francesco Raspi has, in fact, a grandfather, 1740, which is also named Francesco Raspi, which we find another document, and although there were no cadastre at that moment, we can place the shop of Francesco Raspi, the grandfather, in 1740 at the right place in the model, and continue this form of, you know, kind of hyperlink in space and time to make some jumps between different types of document and progressively solving the puzzle. It's a very long work, but it's progressively, you know, changing. And you see that it's like hypertext, but it's also much beyond hypertext because we're dealing with rather complex representation beyond text. Based on this, we can start to have some modeling approach. Since now we had only, you know, document talking with one another, articulation, but then we can go and try to synthesize some representation in a data-driven way. Here, for instance, we have this map of Jacopo de Barbari for the beginning of the 16th century. It's a very good element, although it's not geometrical, to build some representation of how the Rialto neighborhood could actually look like in that period. And this is not supposed to be a nice video at this stage. It starts to be just another type of model, higher level model, to to act like a placeholder, to progressively disinformation we've been finding this big graph, to put them in space and time. That means, for instance, that in all these placeholders, I can find some of the names, I mean, which are going to occupy a given street. The big building you're seeing behind in the video is called the Fondaco de Tedeschi. It's an interesting building because it's where all the, not only the Germans, but all the Americans from the north in general were staying when they were in Venice. They had to stay there after the night, and that was a kind of prototype for the stock exchange, in fact, because they were actually negotiating the price, and it was organized with that particular courtyard. If I'm in a place like this, I can search for documents relating to a given time and space moment. That means that the search engine can also work that way. I'm putting myself virtually at that moment, and I can have some documents. The nice thing with the Fondaco de Tedeschi is that we have a lot of documents dealing with that particular element. And just to show you that an archive is never like a closed system, these are the letters and elements we are finding about the provenance of the different mercants which are there. And you'll see that it's an even denser network of connection for the north of Europe in general than airplanes networks. I mean, we actually are dealing with information that comes from a lot of very important places of the past in Europe at a very fine grain. And we have names, important elements, which are all centered in that particular building. That type of situation, a bit specific because, you know, the Fondaco de Tedeschi was extremely important, you find it more or less the same in the archive in the world. I mean, you would find letters, information, registers dealing not with the city itself, but with its relationship with the rest of Europe. And that's why, I mean, we believe it's extremely important to progressively do the same thing for different places. Coming back to the city itself, when you do this not for a particular specific building, which is the Fondaco de Tedeschi, but with an actual representation of the city, then you can replace one by one all the, in the case, shopkeeper or people who are renting. This is Piazza San Marco in 1740. It looks not so different as it is today, but it's extremely different in practice, in a sense that you see the different shop, you see there are people cutting hairs, selling water, selling socks. It's a very lively place. It's a neighborhood that comes to life. So first, as a form of, you know, immersion, understanding, for instance, that beyond or at the bottom of the San Marco Campanile, you don't have tourists at that moment. You have notary people which are taking acts for, dispute weddings and that type of things, which are sitting there. If you jump now across the roads, which are called the Mercerie, which are still this very commercial road linking Piazza San Marco with the Rialto neighborhood, then you can do the same thing in the neighborhood I've been just showing you to you before, in the beginning of the 16th century, but look how it was inhabited and how it changed in the 1740. And again, you see things that you could have seen potentially transforming the archive step by step, but which are now so easily seenable. The fact that all the shops in that particular street are with jewelers, the fact that the two-thirds of the shops on a given square are owned by the same tenant or the same owner. I mean, all these things that you could do statistically or with Excel file or with database become visually visible, and they integrate the work not of one scholar, but potentially of hundreds of scholars that have been completing the puzzle for different reasons, but as they were doing it, progressively the past becomes a kind of unified representation. And that was like two snapshots. I showed you the Rialto in the beginning of 16th century, and I showed you at the middle of the 18th century, but this also can be done diachronistically. And this is a representation of the evolution starting on 950, always of the same neighborhood, the Rialto neighborhood, based on in that case, archaeological records, secondary sources, many different types of information which can be combined in a single video in that case. But the video is not a pedagogical video, it's a data-driven video. I mean, this is showing the state of the neighborhood at a given moment of our scientific understanding. It may occur that some documentary quality digitizing will change that understanding. It may occur that another scholar which has studied the neighborhood seeing that particular type of integrated representation say, no, wait a minute, you're forgetting completely that there was another type of sources, and that becomes a space of negotiation, the idea of negotiating the space and organizing that negotiation and seeing whether we manage to arrive at single version of that story or several version of that story. And that is something which is extremely interesting culturally, scientifically, epistemologically, and politically to some extent also. Here you see the evolution of the neighborhood, how progressively it got structured, how it got stronger. And you see, for instance, things which are interesting, the acceleration of the urban history at the beginning of the 16th century with a big fire which is destroying Fonaco de Tedeschi and a big fire which is destroying the rest of the neighborhood, which is then reconstructed as such. Like so many other cities in other time of histories, and get how it is based on the assumption of the archivist and the historians of that period. So making, you know, history something that can unfold on your eyes is something which is interesting culturally, but it's also something, and I insist on that, which is important for building an identity, for trying to agree on a common past, and for learning about the lessons that can be learned based on this. We've been doing a single neighborhood here in Venice. What we're going to do in the next 4 years is extending that methodology, making it much more efficient and less costly, let's say, to do the entire Venice. We've been experimenting also how you can actually have people participating, understanding about the project. We've been creating in Lausanne a new building, which one part is dedicated to the project, and it's a rather big success in terms, you know, of crowd. People comes here. The president of Poland visited it two weeks ago. It's a way of putting digital humanities not as something which is hidden, but something which is in direct contact with the population and which is actually creating a form of dialogue and also of contribution. The adventure of the last 4 months has been to try to convince as many as possible partners to go in the same direction. This is the 60 partners, which in the list is still growing, which want to join the adventure. Some join it as archive, and we have many of the national archive in Europe and libraries which are following. Some join because they are actually dealing with a particular technological block, which they want to do. Some already, in fact, did things were extremely similar in the past, and so we were extremely happy to see how Amsterdam was already so advanced. I mean, on this issue, although they may not have, I mean, call it exactly the same way. I mean, we. That there were many cities also dealing now with time in the way they're monitoring, I mean, their evolution. This is extremely encouraging, and the fact that at the occasion of this flagship call, I mean, that digital humanities network, which may not be called digital humanities, I mean, many of these centers are not called or not seen as digital humanities center, but dealing with that particular goal is extremely important. One of the fundamental elements of the which is structuring the project is the fact that all the things we're doing are open source, open data, and open hardware, in the sense that we're pushing as much as possible the local archive, the national archives, to release the data. We are having all the partners agreeing to put the element in open source, in viral open source. That means that all the archive, all the cities can start where we are, in the sense that reusing the type of technology we have to just improve it in a way or another. They have to keep that core patrimony in open source so that any other city can benefit from it. And then the cost for entering in the game is always lower. It's also a way of making sure that there is at least a big set of common technology that permits to deal with the past, understanding how to do it. It's not sure, I mean, that these first prototypes are the right way of doing it, but what is sure is that we need to create a kind of commons on this, and that if these commons could be European commons, that would be extremely valuable, because Europe, of course, is in a very particular situation. I mean, in the world, it is probably in the best position to actually be capable of dealing with these at least 2,000 years of history, of course, potentially even more. And I'm insisting also on open hardware. I mean, we've been starting in that project with using different type of hardware system to deal with the different typologies of document, and some went well, others were less adapted or not done, because mass digitization of elements of the past is something a bit tricky. You need actually to have some flexibility, but also some standardization. And in the last series of scanners we've been producing, we've been designing our own scanners, and they're open hardware. And one of them is dealing with the Phototech. For instance, it's the fastest in the world. It can scan a million photographs in a year and a half, with only 2 person alternating. So it's again something we put in the bucket. No, it's open hardware. So if someone wants to reuse the system, making it different, adding something, it can do it, provided that it stay open and become a common heritage as well as the data. So the dream, I mean, and if Europe could be the leader in that dream, would be that progressively we transform that vision, you know, of our world of today, in a vision which includes something which has been really neglected for, I would say, the last 20 years, which is the depth of time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this very interesting speech, and we have time for a few questions.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, it was very inspiring. My question is technical. Do you think, having such big perspective, that the standards for the intermediate data storage are enough to build such a landscape, or you also think about the new standards for data interoperability in terms of storing the information about the learning process, machine learning process, and many other scenarios you touched?
The thing is that you need to be standardized in any case, and we need to agree and reach common standard. Whether the standards are the right one, not the right one, is an open question. It's good whether they are that they are challenged. In fact, we are in an interesting situation, because they are established standards and they are kind of rising new standards, like IIIF is another one, which is progressively getting momentum in many important institutions, although not being recognized as an official standard. I mean, this is something that needs to be seen in practice, and we should not stick to a given particular standard, but the progress towards standardization is should be the shared goal. And the fact that they are open, I think, is a good way of dealing with the risk of converging on the wrong standard, if that would be a risk. That is just for one aspect, which is the interoperability of the resources. There are many other aspects, long-term preservation. There are standards to imagine for what regard machine learning, deep learning in particular, already is developing in a very unstructured way today. There's no standard in that domain because it's, you know, it's a boom, which is, I guess, normal. I'm not too much worried about that, really. I mean, the thing which is important is having kind of a big series of actors which are sharing similar dreams and trying to agree. I've been observing quite precisely how they do it, for instance, in the IIIF consortium. It's an interesting case of how you can manage efficiency, I think, and governance, but there are other cases like that.
So I didn't want to point a big perspective on the standardization, but the question was much focus on the what is the way to access part of the information you generated in the system in a standardized way, or is the way which is ensured to be continuously available.
So, nobody has the secret for perpetuating digital information. I mean, we've seen how bad is the situation for the last 20. We're not capable of getting anything back from the 90s. So we're in a tricky situation regarding this. What is sure is that if, for instance, is something is done in Amsterdam, something is done in Barcelona for modelizing document, people interaction, I mean, if it needs to talk in some way or another with what is done in Venice and in Warsaw. And so there's so much dynamics for pushing towards standardization that I'm kind of confident this will happen. Now, we need to differentiate the information system itself. I mean, at the level of the actual images, then the information described in RDF, for instance, as semantic standards for describing the knowledge, and then the actual front end on this. I mean, that doesn't mean there's a single website which is the only way of accessing to these. I mean, there could be many different front end, including also local-oriented front end based on the wish of a given city, of a given country to pinpoint some elements and not others, provided that they kind of share the same standard and this contribute to a unique information system. There are a lot of things at stake for tourism in that respect. There are a lot of things at stake for long-term evolution for climate change, epidemiology, and other domains. All these would need specific entry points, but that can be done on the one hand through API and through shared standard. And if we separate well this notion of information system to the notion of access, then I think this is done, this is doable, and we have many, I guess, examples in which that was more or less successful.
Thank you.
Okay, here's one more.
Many thanks for a very interesting project you've been describing there. My question is philosophical, not technological. In your project, in the BRIG project that you're aiming for, and I'm holding thumbs for you for that one, have you also dealt with the potential problem of a reification of culture into data structure? What you're showing us is basically a big graph database that's connecting everything with everything, but you're actually not connecting everything with everything. You've showed us that you're using particular entry points into the data, which is the stuff you can easily grasp, like the Nobis, for example. So there's a filter in there already. Plus, in the original documents and artifacts that you are scanning and digitizing, there's already a filter in them as well, because it is the perspective of an administrator onto a family history, for example. The historical reality of that life might have been completely different. So I think, while on the one hand it is wonderful to link all of this and have this grasp and this ability to zoom into past connectivity, so to speak, there's also a risk of forgetting that we are looking at a representation of that past. We are not looking at the past per se. Is that part of your project as well, to reflect on that problematic?
Well, you're perfectly right, and I think that at least these two dimensions which are problematic. Let's start with the first one, with these, I would say, the asymmetry of representation of some, I would say, countries, content, period versus others, and then we'll deal with the other element of the epistemological issue. That is clear. This is something we observed already in other domain. Could be Wikipedia, for instance, which is giving some information on something, some information of others. It's already true for history in general. I mean, they are focus and attentional point. If we are optimistic on these, and I would guess this is what will happen, but once people are going to understand that the past is a territory and that it's important to structure it in a given way for various reasons, ideological, political, and all that deals not necessarily with objectivity, they're going to be a kind of arm race, in a sense that it's important, if you're the last country in Europe not to be well represented in that element, you should actually start to worry about this. And that was the same thing that happened in Wikipedia to some extent. I mean, if the village of your neighbor is actually well described, you actually, at least we should be there. And then you're going to be describing your village in a given way, maybe not telling some of the things you may not want at all. And then there'll be a process of progressive negotiation, continued negotiation, not necessarily converging. We know that in Wikipedia there are cycling elements. And so I think we're dealing with something which is of that sort, much more complex and less, and potentially less, I would say, easily understandable still than Wikipedia. How can we deal with this? And then as you say, there are two other filters which are adding to the thing. The choice of particular fonts, which are giving some information. The fact that there are errors or all the way down. I mean, errors, intentional, non-intentional, partial reality done in the document, errors included by the scholars themselves, errors including by the algorithm. So my philosophy on that is to deal in the same way that it was dealt with Wikipedia. I mean, full traceability of each of the steps and clear identification of the interpretation steps. And the interpretation steps are almost everywhere, in a sense that they are in the technical interpretation, which are done by some algorithms. And what we are doing and proposing, but it's going to be discussed, of course, is that each of the algorithms are, in fact, more thought as bots, in the sense that they are kind of agentified. They are a given version at a given moment that performs something. May occur that the PhD students working on that thing makes a much better algorithm two years after, we hope it will, and then that means that something occurred before. I mean that the thing that were done by the previous version are done less good, and this needs to be taken into account, and we need to see whether we suppress that information, we tag it, et cetera, et cetera. Same thing for all the users. I mean, what you've been seeing on the reconstruction of Rialto is not something which is done automatically. I mean, search, I mean, getting the element were highly facilitated, but at some point and quite soon, there are human interpretation that based on this, that should be the shape. And this needs to be traceable at the level of individual acts. And we believe if we divide, I mean, the traceability of each of the individual with in the same way we do it for boats, but with individual actors, there's the possibility of organizing and structuring the debate and at least documenting all these biases. And then there are going to be discussion and scholarships about this, and that will not prevent normal users to get misled. But I think we, to some extent, are in something we know about, which has some form of danger, which would need some precious particular cautions, but we will do it anyway.
Okay, we'll have two more questions for the first one.
Well, first of all, thank you for a very enlightening talk. I'm very intrigued by what you're talking about, but I was actually very much intrigued by your introduction where you talked about the social impact and actually compared it to the effect of climate change. So I've sort of been looking for what here is of the level of climate change. And I wonder if you would comment on it, because what I see and what I've heard is it's in a sense a web of knowledge in a very specific area with very nice visualization tools, which can be used. And of course, we all know that a lot of people are interested in themselves, where they live and where they come from. And I can see this providing information on that, but that's not something on the level of climate change. So what actually were you thinking about when you talked about this? The social impact, and
I'm not sure whether I understand the question. Whether it's not like climate change in terms of risk for humanities, or whether it's not also climate change in terms methodologically speaking, or sociologically speaking, or because people are caring about their local. I'm not sure. I will answer both. Okay. It's important. I mean, I think socially speaking, it's important, and that could be a debate, and we'll see whether it's as important or not as big threat for humanity, for culture and society at large. And I think that is something that needs to be discussed. And there, we are maybe starting from, I don't know, worse situation in climate change in that respect. So some people don't care about climate change. Some people care a lot. Think it's extremely important. I think the progressive disappearance of the past is something as threatening as climate change in that respect, but it's maybe my opinion, and this is clearly something political, ideological, complex that needs to be discussed as society at large, which is to some extent what people will do in Brussels in a week, although it's not very at large, it's only 50% and it's much smaller. But this is something which is highly important, socially speaking, or at least there should be a debate on whether this is socially important. In terms of relationship with locality, I think this is one of the main strength we have, I would say, in a case like that, compared to many other scientific issues. I mean, project about the brains, project about new type of computers, project about physics, end up having huge consortia of people which are agreeing or not agree, disagreeing, essentially, on the way to do, because science is extremely cleavant to that respect. Where here we are potentially, although the past is something extremely political, ideological, etc., in something which may lead naturally to some form of distribution, in the sense that, as you say, people care about their local history first. Their local history contains a bit of the local history of others. Potentially, also, we can create dynamics in which some form of financement comes locally, so which means that the entire system can potentially perpetuate itself with some bias progressive of who have more money than others, but what we can compensate with open source and open hardware. And that would potentially, I mean, we've seen it already with the consortium we have created to some extent. And that consortium is, for the moment, not a place of highly passionate debate, because people feel, I mean, already doing locally what was done, it would be a source of learning and an element. And that, I guess, is different from almost all the other domain of science. I'm not sure I answered your question, but I tried.
Okay, and the last question and the rest of them, I suggest we will have some discussion afterwards, but the last question.
Thank you so much. It was really intriguing. Many respects, and I cross all my fingers for your success. I have a simple question. There's an elephant in this room. This is Google, with 30 million books, buildings, and thank you, maps, and also. So, what's the relation of your projects to Google? Thanks.
So, Google. First, Google has become so big that it's difficult to talk about this with a name, you know, because Google is... When you look at what Google is doing, you should a bit... And I had discussion because I know quite well the people of Google Books, and I've been retalking with them recently. If you check, I mean, they're not doing that anymore, really. It's a bit strange, but no, we still have the mythology of Google 10 years ago, where they were the one doing the Enlightenment dreams, and it was criticized, and they would be the one putting all the knowledge on Earth and blah, blah. They're not doing it anymore, to some extent. I mean, the Google Books case is still something which we'll see how it will actually impact economically. They're not so much interested in, I mean, the Google Art Project is still active at its own rhythm. Google has been transforming a much more rational company, to some extent, doing things which are linked with its business model, getting bigger. So they're not knocking on the doors. I mean, that is the first thing. So the question, why is not Google doing it? I mean, we had a meeting with Eric Schmidt. So Eric Schmidt came 2 years ago at EPFL, and we presented the project. And he said, oh, cool. First, he said, we don't know how to do this, which was my main fear, that you'd look completely ridiculous in front of the CEO of Google. And second, go ahead. And never say no. So don't expect Google to do it. Before to discuss whether it would be a good idea, whether Google is doing it or not. This being said, the thing which will happen is not that one. It's not. I think cultural heritage will not be taken care so much by others, apart maybe for the genealogical elements, which now, in which there's an extreme boom now with family search and others, and this is extremely active. These are good business created about scanning register records and tracing back families over a generation, because there are people ready to pay for this. Apart from that, these actors are going to become patrimonial actors without wanting to be it. I mean, Google has the Google Street View records over a couple of years, and now they're putting it, and so they are becoming an archive for that reason. They have all our data, which is now the present. In 20 years, it's not the present anymore, it's the past. Facebook has more and more dead person every day, which they don't know what to do with it, because this is a change of business. Whether they will do it, whether they will forget about it, whether they will hand out this to somebody else, maybe some entities which are supposed to last, which is the key idea of archive, well, we don't know yet. But I'm sorry, we have to do the job.
Okay, thank you very much.